Jesus prayed this same prayer on the cross.
Jesus.
But he added one word. He said, Father. And in doing so, he proclaimed his relationship as son to Father. And here Jesus taught us how to die as a child in the arms of his Father. In my ministry, I've had people ask me. I remember a guy that was in the church we were pastoring one time said to me, visiting with him in the Holy Spirit office, and he said, Dave, what's it like to die? I've been there. I don't know. And I said, well, John, I think it's like this. His wife's name is Vonnie. I said, when Vonnie makes dinner and it's ready, what does she say to you? And he said to me, well, she says, old man, get out here and get it. I said, what do you do, John? He said, I get up and I go into the other room. I said, so it is when you die, John. You slip into the other world.
Right.
Jesus died as he lived in a relationship and in prayer with his Father.
Praise God.
Yeah.
Hallelujah.
I heard the story of a man who was a very successful butcher and deli owner. And throughout the whole metropolitan area where he lived, he had many of these delicatessens and stores. And his children, his sons and his daughters were in the business with him. And he was in his final days, maybe even his final hours. And one of his children said to him, Papa, give us something that we can use to continue on with your success. And the father looked at him and said, slice the ham thin. You see, he was dying as he lived. Jesus died as he lived, close to the Father. This verse speaks of trust. The Father's hands are trustworthy.
Amen.
Come on, dads, you said this already. I won't drop you. I won't let you go when you're teaching the kids how to ride the bike. I won't let you go. I won't let you fall. Get up there and change that light bulb. Pop's too heavy to get up on the ladder. You get up there and change that light bulb for Pop. I won't let you sink when you're teaching them to swim. The Father's hands are trustworthy. And in death, he says, Father, into thy hands I commend my spirit.
Yeah.
It is in a Father's hands that we soothe. You know, I'm a far better grandfather than I was a father. I will tell you that right now. My heart just goes out to the three grandchildren I have. You want to soothe them. You want to console them. My brother told me one time where I was chastising one of my kids and he was there. My brother said, now, you have to take the sandwiches. You have to do good, bad, good, you know. You know, you have to tell them what they did wrong. You got to put some good stuff in there. He said, what I would suggest is you say to them, you really messed up, but you messed up better than anybody I've ever seen. I got a chuckle out of that. But we console. That's okay. You did your best. Come here, Pop. Come here, Pop. Come here, Pop. That's what the grandkids call me. Pop. 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 Come here, Pop. Let me love you. Let me take you up in my hands. Take you up in my arms. It's there we reassure them. It's there that we bring cheer. It's there that we make them physically comfortable. Why do kids come to you when they have a boo-boo? They want to be loved on. And in his final moments, what did Jesus do? He cried out, Papa.
Yeah.
Papa, Daddy, Abba, Father. See, it was that moment that Jesus would realize, what Paul would realize, and he said, Father, I reckon the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us.
Hallelujah.
In John chapter 10, verse 27 through 29, Jesus talks about the Father's hands there. He says, "My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. And I give unto them eternal life, and they shall never perish. Neither shall any man pluck them out of my hand. My Father, which gave them me, is greater than all. And no man is able to pluck them out of my Father's hand." In the hands of the Father, there is security. But Jesus had fallen victim to the hands of wicked men. In Acts chapter 2, Peter says, "Ye men of Israel, hear these words. Jesus of Nazareth, a man approved of God among you by miracles and wonders and signs which he did by him in the midst of you, as ye yourselves also know. Him being delivered by the determinate counsel and foreknowledge of God," yes, it was in the will of God, "ye have taken, and by wicked hands have crucified and slain." You see, in the hands of wicked men, he was illegally arrested. In the hands of wicked men, they whipped his back, that the flesh flew out each time the executioner pulled the cat of nine tails back. Flesh would fly out of his back. They beat him. They slapped him. They punched him in the face. His visage was marred above that of any man. This was at the hands of wicked men, after he had already performed miracles and wonders in their midst and was approved by God by those miracles. They pounded a crown of thorns on his head. They placed a robe of mockery on him. And then with wicked hands, they nailed him to the cross. Wicked hands did all they could do to destroy Jesus. But now Jesus, at the end of his ordeal, remembers whose hands he is truly in. He's in his Father's hands. Hey, true peace, true joy comes from committing our spirits, our lives and our beings into the hands of the Father.
Yeah.
The Bible teaches about two types of peace. I talked about it earlier. Peace with God and the peace of God. The peace of God which passes all understanding. We will never have the peace of God until we are at peace with God.
Yeah.
And the only way to be at peace with God is to fall into the hands of the Almighty.
Amen.
And Jesus taught us that. He taught us how to die.
Praise
God. We read in Hebrews,
"Hallelujah.
Looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross,
Amen.
Despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. For consider him that endured such contradiction of sinners against himself, lest ye be wearied and faint in your minds." There's a hymn. I thought of this hymn tonight. I want to read just a chorus. It's the hymn "Softly and Tenderly." "Come home, come home. Ye who are weary, come home. Earnestly, tenderly, Jesus is called, calling, O sinner, come home."
Yes.
Come home.
When
I was a kid, things were a little bit different. Pardon me, you could let a 10-year-old ride his bike around the neighborhood. You know, we lived next to the high school, and the junior high had been there. The elementary was there at one time, grades 4 through 12, and then they go to new school. But it was amazing. We had the schoolyard, and then down below the school, there was this great big open area that had sidewalk that went all around it. That's a football stadium to a kid, let me tell you. We had two end zones and two sidelines. And there was a flagpole in the middle. And If you got the ball past the flagpole, that was your first down. And we ride our bikes. Now, we knew where we could go and where we couldn't go. We couldn't leave 5th Street in Newport. We could go up to 6th Street. But as it would start to get dark, we'd hear Dad whistle. Or we'd hear, Tim! That's my brother. Tim, come home! My grandmother, when she was dying, my mother's mother, for 2 weekends in a row, she hallucinate visions. I believe it was visions. She talked as if she was already in heaven. She described it. She would sing, we couldn't understand what she was singing. Then our times we would, and then she'd be real quiet for the longest of times. My brother came the one Saturday, it always happened a Saturday into a Sunday morning. The second weekend was when she passed away. But she said to my brother at one time, she said, Tim, that man wants you. My brother wasn't saved. Tim said, what man? She'd been gazing off and she turned and she looked at him and she said, that man with the nail prints in his hand, Tim, he wants you.
Hallelujah.
Last spring, I watched my brother be water baptized. Hallelujah. And grandma's been dead 25 years or more. We hear it start to get dark. We hear, David! Come home! Come on! It's time to come home. Let me tell you, folks, come home before dark. Come now. Come. And in coming, come for yourselves and come for someone else that needs to come home before dark. We have sons, we have daughters, we have brothers and sisters, aunts and uncles, moms and dads, friends and neighbors and co-workers. They need to come home before dark. Come home! Softly and tenderly, Jesus is calling. And he's calling you into the hands of his Father.
Oh, hallelujah.
Tonight I'm coming home. But one day, I tell my kids, I don't know when. Dad died at 44, Mom died at 63. I don't know when. It'll probably come unexpected. I remember when my grandmother died, we looked at her, beginning to not be able to breathe. Earlier in the day, she said to me, David, I'm so nervous. I said, why, Grandma? She said, I don't know. I said, you don't need to be. You know Jesus. You're saved. Jesus is in your heart. And I prayed with her. About 45 minutes later, I said, Grandma, are you still nervous? She said, no. God gave her dying grace. But as she began to have trouble breathing, she looked up at us. And it was as if we were being directed by a great orchestra director. Several of us looked at her and at the same time said, go ahead, Grandma, it's okay. You can go. Because she was walking into the hands of the Father. One more quick thing. Years ago, there was the Assemblies of God. I was in the Assemblies of God at the time. They have a campus ministry called Chi Alpha. And the Chi Alpha pastor at the University Park of Penn State was a young man named Dave Willis. And he had a beautiful young wife named Diane. This is 30-some years ago. My daughter, my oldest daughter, will be, plug your ears, Rachel. She'll be 31 this month. So it had to be at least 30 years old. Rachel was a year old. But Dave and Diane had a little girl also that was about Rachel's age. And they left their little girl with mutual friends of ours while they went to the March on Washington for the March for Life. And on the way home, gave us tiger. Somewhere outside, Valentina Day fell asleep, and the car ran off the road, and Diane died. They were in the car for about 45 minutes before they were found on that foggy, lonely country road. They said, I reached over when I got my bearings, and I put my hand on Diane, and I knew she was gone. A pastor friend of mine called me today, Diane Willis is dead. We've got to go to the funeral. Went to the funeral at the State College of Sunday. God, there must have been 1,000 or more people. It was cut-wrenching. It was hard because they brought her casket in after we were all seated. And behind the casket came Dave carrying his one-year-old little girl. Behind Dave was her parents. Behind her parents were her brothers and sisters. And then Dave's family and his brothers and sisters. It's tough. But I'll never forget what the pastor of that church said. As soon as he stood up to open that service, he said he gave the date, whatever it was, January something. At 4:43 in the morning, Diane Willis walked into the arms of Jesus. Hallelujah. So folks,
praise God.
Come home. And come for someone else that needs to come home. Will you stand with me?